One. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the NALCS Promotional Qualifiers, and boy do we have a matchup for you. Game number three coming your way, Falafel gaming up against Project Challenger, tied up 1-1. That means that this game is for all the marbles. And once again, big thanks to Riot Teaser for his lovely stream this evening. I'm the FourCourtJester with me today, the L3IRD. We're streaming on the Twitch. Hit us up, let us know what you think. And Mr. Bird, we got some bands on the table.
Yeah, we do have some bands. We have some Raz bands, Nosses, and the Volley Bear for the team of, I think it's Falafel Gaming on the blue side again. So Falafel can be doing some, I think, pretty standard bands. I don't think there's anything different. The Raz band is definitely directed at that Raz player at the mid. It was a really good one coming out from Eevee card, so they're going to change that one up over there. On the other hand, Project Challenger could bend out the Moomoo, Rumble, and now the Cho'Gath. The Cho'Gath proved to be a very, very decisive thing during that game on number two, and they're gonna go ban that one out because, again, Cho'Gath was their game number one, Cho'Gath here in number two. They don't want it to be here in number three and, well, wrecking their day. So, very good to see those bans coming out and the picks as well.
Who did they ban last time? It was Ryze. Yeah, so Ryze is actually still there, but no Shen ban this time either. So, some decent reaction coming out from both teams. Poor Moomoo, poor Rumble, never going to get played ever.
I'm surprised at the Rumble, but it is actually just a ban against, Symbolic, because Symbolic does play a really good Rumble, but he could go again with that Vladimir, although not doing successful in that game number one. In game number three, it could be a little bit different, especially with Zingy, probably going to be playing the J4 yet again.
Yeah, he has been, he did prove really powerful last game with that J4. He's somehow still able to defeat not only Elise, Repels, and Neurotoxins, but Paranoias and Fears. This is actually really impressive when it came down to brass tacks. But yeah, J4 there, we got the Misfortune, Sona. Once again, I think those are 3-3 picks. Both of those through all three games. But once again, Caitlyn as well. And I believe we had a Janna game number one on top of things.
Yeah, I mean, the Janna is going to be really interesting and very useful. If they had that response of the Zingy Karthus, but Zingy wouldn't play that. It could be now, it could be changed to Kha'Zix jungle, which would be interesting to see as well. And especially to see the Elise being picked up for the team Project Challenger. I think it was Falafel Gaming picking up last game, no game for the first one. And we could possibly see a Zac as well. So a lot of new things coming up from both teams. Zac is a really interesting jungler right now.
I'd be tickled pink if we actually got ourselves a Zac, but you think it would be a Zac jungle and not a Xin Zhao?
I mean, it could be Xin in the top, it could be Zac in the mid as well. I've seen that before, that's kind of crazy. Zac top lane could work out as well, so a solo lane a Zac would be pretty cool, but I'm kind of holding my breath. I don't know if the team Project Challenger is going to go use that one.
I have not yet cast a high-level game of Zac. I have not yet done it. I'd be tickled pink if it actually happened here. Flip side though, Kha'Zix. Haven't seen him in a bit, but he's a very strong pickup here for Season 3, especially if he does rock mid, which is very likely at this point.
Yeah, it's probably going to be over there at that mid. Unfortunately, we're going to have Mimo pick up the Gragas. They wanted the Zac so bad so that Roy Tain or somebody else could go support Xin, and it'd be the greatest of things. Or it could be a support Gragas, which would be really cool. But it's pretty much going to level out Xin and Xin in the jungle. We have that Gragas at mid, possibly in Cloud X over in that top, possibly bottom lane as well with that Elise.
Alright, so unfortunately it's not going to be that Zac. Q. But, you know, Gragas, if he's been studying the style of Skara, Skara plays a really mean Gragas. And EV card, I mean, game number one, he was Ryze, and he ended up 15-3 by the end of the game. His Jace, unfortunately, not nearly so strong, so let's see if he's a bit more at home on AP, or maybe something was a placeholder.
No, it was the Tizza scene where their room page was glitched. They were making champ select and all picks will be preserved.
Oh, cool. Yeah, Riot Tizza in his own stream. all right, so rune page glitch. Those nasty glitches. Get out of here. But either way, okay, so those are going to be our picks. What do you think of a Gragas in mid up against Kha'Zix?
It's going to be dangerous. Kha'Zix can get some good damage when he can, but the poke is going to be really strong from Gragas in the beginning, and especially many people don't know the attack speed debuff that comes into play with your Q from the barrel roll. That's actually going to play a little bit of a key during this. There's a little bit of engagements, there's fights at that mid with Kha'Zix. Although I would think Kha'Zix could win out the late run, especially with Void Spike, being involved in all the damage output that you get from there. Don't think it's going to come into play for that. I especially think both of the mid laners are going to roam either top or bottom lane, and it's going to be whoever gets there first and gets the kill fastest will win out the actual mid lane matchup. Whoever gets the roam, that's going to be even better. That'll be the best thing for both teams.
Well, best thing of both from both teams could definitely go a long way. As you see here, guys, it is the online promotional qualifier in North America. Falafel Gaming and Project Challenger, they are tied up 1-1, and the picks have now already been settled. I guess we're just waiting for that glitch to go away. I hope that somebody didn't log out and there's like a 20,000 queue, because that would suck.
Yeah, that would make the waiting game maybe an hour or so longer, and the whole schedule would be pushed back, so that wouldn't be probably too key for Tizza to have that happen over there. I think the ADC match was Caitlyn, and I don't think it was Misfortune, but it could be Misfortune.
Yeah, and it was Misfortune. Misfortune, it was Misfortune up against the Caitlyn Janna.
Then yeah, I mean, we've only seen Misfortune and Caitlyn quite a bit in NA. Well, on the EU side, Caitlyn has been picked up or banned out a few times, but we've seen a lot of Varus play. Mm-hmm. Really interesting to see the differences between both regions.
Yeah, Varus has definitely been picked up quite a bit. He's also been very prevalent in the weekly Alienware series that we do. And when we did the overclock here in North America, mm-hmm. about 2 weeks ago, he was a very prevalent pick on the second place? I think it was the second place team. I mean, I think they ran him the entire tournament. Nobody bothered banning him at all. But yeah, Varus, a lot of early game damage, especially with that rain of arrows. I mean, the range on that, and then throw it into a Q, especially with a nice support, you could really land some huge damage combos early game, and that could lead into some nice snowballing action.
Yeah, definitely, and we do see the team's gonna be locked in yet again. I mean, I'm liking Cybolic playing it off on the cannon again. I'm going to be playing against that at least. That's a dangerous thing. So, what's going to happen this time? I think CloudX High is going to be swapping down the bottom lane, unfortunately. Cybolic, yeah, he did have the lane advantage with the CS. He did have the damage advantage once he hit around the mid game to late game go. So, CloudX High, yeah, he could possibly win out in the lane phase against Cybolic, but then again, I feel like CloudX High is the thing that you're going to have to watch out for. Again, he was pretty much the key factor for the team Project Challenger in that second game to kind of win out some fights and kind of lose out some fights as well. But the biggest thing is, well, Falafel Gaming, they have pretty much the same comp as they did in last game. I mean, Misfortune on top of the Slicing Mushroom, on top of the Crescendo, or on top of the Reno time. It's just really, really good stuff that's coming out from Falafel Gaming.
Yeah, unfortunately we don't have that Cho'Gath this round. He was their, you know, more recent ban. So Cho'Gath, I thought Cho'Gath did extremely well in that mid when he did go up against Jason. I mean, we did have a little bit of concern as to his survivability or his, you know, being able to poke back to Jace. But again, Valkyrin with his last hits were just really spot on. He was able to keep up no problem. So this time, yeah, if it ain't fixed, don't break it. Wow. If it ain't broken, don't fix it. And Falafel, I mean, they got 4 of the 5 same picks this round. So, you know, momentum going forward, they know that they can play this comp. I'm just going to be very interested to see if Gragas can kind of help clear the air, because when they kind of do collapse on that, that's where the explosive cask is really going to come in handy.
Yeah, hopefully that'll be the key for Project Challenger, because that misposition, the disposition that Falafel Gaming will be in off on top of the explosive cask will be the biggest thing that's going to happen for the team Project Challenger. If they can push it out at that mid game with the damage output that comes out from Gragas, that comes out from technically Caitlyn as well, it'll be really key. Again, another thing that they do have for repositioning is the Crescent Sweep off of Shin. Shin's going to do a lot of good damage as well. If we can get a really good counter gank or counter jungle off of Zhongli in the early go, that could lead into a lot of good things. And again, Zhongli hasn't been the strongest of junglers actually between the game number 1 and game number 2. I think at one point, Wild Mimo was like at 62 CS compared to like 38 of Zhongli, and Zhongli was just falling behind each and every time. So Wild Mimo does have that to boot, so hopefully he can take those advantages in and try to win out in that long run as at least the jungler.
Yeah, if you told me that Azingi was really well known for his last hits, I just might call you crazy, Bird. I mean, Azingi's known for his Azingi builds.
Yeah.
It gets the kills. Game number one, he had 6 of 6 kills by the 15-minute mark. Like, he was just on fire with that Karthus before he became a glass cannon despite his best attempts. Game number two, sure, didn't have the best of kills, didn't have the best of the creeps, but he made the plays happen. The wombo combo was complete, and they won the game. So yeah, you want to tell me that he's not the best of farmers? I'll totally agree, but I'll say that that's not exactly why Zingy's on this team.
Yeah, I know. Zingy is doing what he does, and that's why he gets Zingy sometimes dying in a little bit of awkward places. But then again, I think in this time, they are playing out really well in Falafel Gaming. They're going to show up a really good game. And again, their comp is pretty much the same, other than Valkyrie switching up into a Kha'Zix. The assassination attempts are going to happen on his aces. That's going to be very key. If the aces can't stay alive, the Team Project Challenger does not really have a chance. And especially with Valkyrie coming in, lurking around, trying to get some kills, it might be some dangerous times for them.
Dangerous times ahead. It is tied up 1-1. The winner of this will move on in the promotional tournament to play yet again tomorrow here on the Four Court Jester and the Bird stream. But right now, we got to get down to brass tacks, Mr. Bird. 1-1. Winner of this takes home the series. Is it going to be this wombo combo comp coming out from Lawful, or is it going to be more of this get out of my face comp from Challenger? As you said, we got the Monsoon, we got the Explosive Cask, we got the Sweeping Strikes. Is it going to be enough to counter out this damage?
I will say yes or no, but I will say maybe. You know, call me maybe sometime, because that could be a really good answer sometime later on. I just have to reference I had to reference that because we were casting the EU, although we didn't cast the actual game. It was just really interesting to see that, Hey, I Just Met You was the qualifiers did again for the EU tournament. Although they renamed TCM, but Hey, I Just Met You, that's a pretty good name.
I like how Riot Teaser actually created this, like, overlay for his thing, and then he always forgets to turn it off when we switch games. So I'm looking at, like, a blank air client.
I think he has the client just like that, so it's separated from the actual game, which is very smart, so they can still talk to people off of there.
Yeah, that's what I do. I cover up my messages and everything, but switch it, damn it! I hear the game starting!
Oh man.
I just give up
man.
Trying to time my music to go into the picks and bans. I just give up. Or go into the loading screen. Picks and bans. I start the music, like, I give myself 45 seconds or so to get the load in working, and it just never works. Arg.
Well, we're going to do the radio cast yet again. I hear some things starting up. The Mustang Siren going down, and we'll see what will happen in just this little bit. Or not see, but at least hear.
Yeah, we're going to have to do our radio cast from game number one as Teez has to get all of his ducks in a row. And there we go. Awesome. That's good to say. I did hear the Jarvan standard go down a few wards. We can see Waka Waka there in the bush as well. So a lot of wards actually in this bot area. I mean, this river to bot lane already has 3 wards from Team Challengers, so that's going to be, you know, really high priority, I wonder. We don't see any kind of lane switches going by, and Cybolic is, of course, going to be top, and Teeza remembered that Cybolic's top. Yay, I like that.
I think it was Claudex, that's the thing they were... Oh, no, you're right, Cybolic was top, so... maybe it's not going to say anything about a lane swap, but maybe there is a lane swap actually happening, unfortunately.
I just realized that I called Crescent Sweep Sweeping Strikes. For whatever reason, I forgot. Stupid thing. Blah, blah, blah. Ben, there we go. Sorry about that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we're all good. All good. Game number 3. No more problems. No more screw ups. And as I said, for the lane swaps, it looks like Aces and Rule 18 went all the way to the bottom, warded, and now we're all the way to the top. So I guess that might be just more of a visual cue to Falafel. They're saying, all right, we're going to be bottom. So that kept their ADC's bottom. And now Cybolic has to go 2-on-1 top. And I wouldn't have pegged him as a really big 2-versus-1 champ.
Yeah, but the thing is, he did start off with the 42 pot yet again, and the 42 pot, what it does, it allows you some access to a little bit more health when you do get ganked upon. That's why you saw in the LCS before, when they actually did have that nerfing damage on towers, 330 in, you can see two junglers trying to counter gank each other, or hit that ganking mark over the top lane slash the bottom lane, and try to just counter gank each other. Having that extra fortitude pop really helps you with that extra health, that just immediate health that's effective, but also just really keeps you in that goal. One problem is, it's going to be really hard for CloudX High yet again. You're going to try to 2v1 this bottom lane, which again, Waka 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 and Baby Zeus are just pounding out of this turret right now.
Yeah, and that's to be expected this early game. I mean, at this rate, we should see a tower die from either side between the 5 and 6 minute mark. It seems to be about the typical, and we also see right now a Wild Mimo top lane. They're really going to try to push that in, so they might be going for that really, really quick tower kill to get that lane swap going. It's really going to force Cybolic out of lane as well. Row 18, however, looked like he was tanking a tower, not entirely too sure why. We don't have any jungle help coming top. Where's the Zingy? Zingy's bottom, so they're doing exactly the same thing. He's right in front of my eyes.
Yeah, and we're gonna see everyone push up each and every way for bottom and top.
Wow.
We're gonna try to see Falafel Gaming push up a little bit more on bottom and Project Gadget on top.
3:30, both sets of towers go down. That is extremely early.
Yeah, it's just the pace that the teams want to play at. Again, I don't think Cybolic wanted to be in a 2v1 lane, and same thing with CloudX High. Although the team probably wanted to do that, and that's why we saw Aces in Rule 18 over in top lane, I don't think Elise really enjoys being 2v1 / 3v1 at this point over in the bottom lane.
Yeah, it's definitely the 3v1 in both lanes at this point. Like, the junglers are not leaving. I almost want to call this a base race, although it's more of a lane race, but Valkyrie, he's going to jump in here. He just gets absolutely crushed. He's not going to be of any help here. In fact, he could very easily get tower dived right now, but the towers are just melting. Top lane, or bottom lane, Cloud, he's going to have to use that repel. Looks like he will be okay for now. Where's Gragas in all this? Gragas is going to come down bottom as well. That could be a kill on top of Waka Waka Waka. There's the barrier on top of things, and all of a sudden, it's like, who cares about mid lane? It's all about the sides.
Yeah, it's all about the sides right now, and we do see all the mid laners actually trying to rotate and help out as well. Overall, just a little good take. I especially like what Project Challenger was doing. They kept on pushing. Now they're going to try to rotate mid and push in all the way. They knew that everybody kind of backed away from blue side and making sure they can try to push up even more so on that middle turret.
Shout out to Cruiser the Bruiser in stream. I'd ask him to tweet, but I don't think he knows me that well. But either way, he's enjoy the stream there, bro. Mid tower gonna be dropping real low. Valkyrie not really able to do too much here. Zingy's gonna come in. That's gonna be the knock up. Here comes Kennen on top of things. That's gonna be the rush out from EV card. Mimo, however, yeah, he's gonna pop out that flash. He does have an ignite on top of him as well. Zingy able to get off of one more auto attack on top of Janna. Sona has now come to the mid with Waka Waka. And are we gonna see like early dragon? It's 5 minutes in.
I would think so, because a Wild Mimo took a lot of damage, plus he used out the flash really early. Unfortunately, you're going to be able to get that away. The biggest thing is the middle turret should go down, and a Wild Mimo is going to try to chance this. I personally think that Wild Mimo should have just took the one shot, one kill onto that turret, because it's just going to take about 2 shots over there. But yeah, we're going to see that happen in the play, and unfortunately Wild Mimo trying to go over the top lane, losing that dragon control, and Cybolic just responds with a teleport over the top. Great little take from Falafel Gaming, waking up and making sure they can take their advantages on a global map.
My goodness. So all of a sudden, those 40-minute sweet spot games, we've had more action in 6 minutes than we have the previous two games at this point. But yeah, 6 minutes in, both sets of towers are down. Lots of damage on that top one. Mid's now gone as CloudXHigh finally finishes it off. And it's just kind of throwing the meta out of the window at this point. It's just who can push down enough towers, who can get that early game cash and end this game as quick as they can.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty much the key. The only problem is they have two top laners that kind of need to hit an iron item mark within the next 10 to 15 minutes. And so we're probably going to see a slowdown, and probably going to see a slowdown of the game, especially with everybody just rocking out really fast. I mean, yeah, they can still rush the turrets. They can probably take down the mid turret for Falafel Gaming off on Project Challenger side, and that's probably what they're going to be doing, at least with three people at mid. But overall, I would see a slowdown, especially for Elise. She needs to catch up right now. 20 to 31 on the CS score. She's not having a really good time over in that top lane as well.
Look at Jarvan down here. Zingy saying, all right, well, the jungle is no place to be right now. He even used a smite on a cannon creep. But he's just going to be wave playing that bot lane. We got the ADC just kind of pushing in on the mid. But Jin's going to come in from the side. That's going to be on top of Waka Waka. I don't think we have that barrier ready to go. The explosive cask is going to get defeated by the flash from Waka Waka. But, you know, really good attempt from Project Challenger. And, you know, with these towers down, I'm curious to see if we're going to see more and more aggressive jungle ganks, because we don't have those safety nets or that map control anymore.
Yeah, that would be a very interesting thing. I don't know if there's going to be actually jungle pressure anymore. I'm pretty sure even with Falafel Gaming's tactic, I mean, J4, with the Demacia standard, you're going to be able to get that attack speed bonus that you're going to pop in, popping the damage onto the turrets or so. So I wouldn't be surprised at all if Falafel Gaming just keeps on pushing. But they need to slow down this game because they do need to get the items on both, not really Valkyrie, but at least on Misfortune. And on to Kennen. Again, Kennen rushed into Zhonya's after going to hunting guys. He's going to do the same thing. It's going to take a little while. I think it took about, let's say about 18, 19 minutes last game. And hopefully that is going to be the key for Cybolic for this one.
It's 8 minutes in. We got three towers down. In terms of the gold, it's still relatively even back and forth despite that extra global gold. From the tower, we did get that early, like 6 minute dragon for Falafel, so that's kind of where that evenness comes out. In terms of creeps going back and forth, it's really not that different, although Gragas has taken somewhat of a commanding lead over top of Kaze, so that's a 14 difference. It's the biggest discrepancy as our ADCs are pretty much evened out, as well as our top lanes, but Flash coming out from Baby Zeus. They did see that teleport coming in from Cloud XI, and unfortunately that will be a wasted teleport, but that's okay. We don't have, you know, Kennen or Cybolic top lane to kind of make anything of it, so he's just going to have to defend, wait for the creep wave, and then push on out. And it's really dangerous to push on out that far in the top because we don't really have sufficient ward coverage there, and we don't have that tower to fall back to.
And that's going to be the problem for the team of Falafel Gaming. I mean, that top lane turret, I think it's at about a half health. It's not really going to mean long for this world as well. And Project Challenger is saying, well, we're going to keep on pushing. They're going to go over the bottom lane, push this down. And with all tier 1 turrets going to be down within the next about 3 to 5 minutes, for the side of Falafel Gaming, they're going to have a lot of vision issues, and hopefully they do not get caught out, especially with a Gragas rotating up and down. He'll be able to get explosive cast and do some stuff, and oh, that first blood. Great job by Cloud XI yet again, getting the double lifting Serena right there. Baby Zeus just checking that bush a little too long.
Wow, yeah, absolutely no wards right there. Now we do have Sona with that first blood. She's going to go back and get herself a Philo Stone. That was a nice cocoon coming out from Cloud XI, but it's not going to be within tower range, so Zingy's not going to be able to really force any kind of return kill here. But again, like this early game without these towers, we don't have that map control, we don't have the safety net, we don't even have sight stones out either. But Valkyrie, he's going to get hit by the explosive cast. He's going to dodge out the next shot there from Card, but apparently we're going to go bottom because it's more important, as it does look like Kha'Zix will live for now. There's nobody chasing him. The Ignite was used from EV Karn, but it's not going to be enough to take him down. So bot lane gets defended. Kha'Zix gets away from mid. Mimo up top using Smite to his advantage on top of creeps, just like a Zingy was bot. It's a crazy game.
Yeah, it's definitely a crazy game, and looking pretty good from Project Challenger's side right now, 13.8 to 13.5k gold. So they're up a little bit of gold, but I mean, it's kind of coming out in lanes right now, 75 and 61. So even at the bottom, ahead and middle, unfortunately behind it, we're in top lane. And Cybolic is going to be playing a big role in the next few minutes. He has that TS lead, although it doesn't have the item advantage just yet. He's going to get that also up as well. And it's going to be a dangerous time for Cloud XI. I mean, yeah, he did get a great assist over that bottom lane with that teleport gank, but was it really worth it? Because he's falling a little bit behind each and every time he goes back.
Yeah. Zingy has himself a ward. We have nobody else except Cybolic. He just picked one up. But two wards on the table and none on the map except for the top lane. You can see one kind of way up here in the tribush. But, okay, maybe there's one here and one at Dragon. But either way, things are going to be ticking down. We've run out of those wards. Jarvan's going to be throwing down his last one. Dragon's about to come up in the next 45 seconds, 30 seconds. And you can already see them clustering down there. That's going to be a note here for Project Challenger. They don't have any ward coverage here. There's the Dragon as is. Kind of thought these died closer to the 6 minute mark, but either way, ace in the hole, Baby Zeus is going to be able to eat it no problem, and that's going to be more gold in the pocket of Falafel. And top lane, however, look at that convergence of red.
Yeah, it looks like they're going to push down onto this turret no problem. Roll 18 ace is going to go catch on a Waka Waka Waka, and we're going to see if he's going to get off of this one. Yeah, Baby Zeus will go support that one up, but that is going to be a trade off for the second tier turret over in top lane. Very good stuff coming out from Project Challenger.
So every time we grab a dragon, it's an extra turret going the way of Project Challenger. Now, in terms of the gold trade-off, it's pretty similar, but in terms of, again, that map control, that safety net, it's going to be really hurting Falafel, because look at this, the gank from behind coming in from Challenger. That's not going to be a cocoon, but the Spiderling will hit. We got the teleport coming down, as well as the Zingy throws down for that cataclysm. You can see the monsoon just making great use of it there, as well as that bullet time. This is the comp that Challenger needs to run in order to defeat that wombo combo, because not only did they knock Jarvan out of his own cataclysm, the bullet time did not do as nearly as much damage. I don't think the crescendo actually hit anything either.
Yeah, a lot of dodges coming out from that general. Also, great job by Roller team getting that one down and really helping out the team secure themselves and get in out of there. But they're going to have so much pressure still at this middle turret. Waka waka waka, going to try to do a little bit more damage on there, but it's just going to kind of bait and switch each and every time. 73 and 79 on the CS score over in that bottom lane. I think actually Caitlyn's all... No, she's actually behind because of two dragons right now, but overall she's almost as pretty much even with that misfortune. Although the item difference is going to be pretty substantial. Yep, we do see the Bloodthirster almost set up for Caitlyn. On the other hand, misfortune already built into that Bloodthirster without any boots to boot.
Yeah, no boots, but she does have strut, and a lot of misfortune players, they don't really need to rush boots like they would, for example, like a Varus or a Severity, because you don't have those escape mechanisms, but the strut can get her from point A to point B pretty much just as fast, and during the fight, I mean, she's really going to be depending upon things like a Zingy cataclysm and the crescendo just to keep people in line so that she doesn't really need to worry about those boots, and that lets her get damaged just that much earlier. So 13-minute Bloodthirster, I mean, I think it's a little early. Typically, I see them around 14 minutes, but it's also a sign of a good amount of farm. She has 84 creeps to her name, 74 to that of Caitlyn, but that global gold coming in is definitely a big factor.
Yeah, definitely. And we're going to see CloudX High going to push over in this bottom lane, probably take down this bottom turret. Waka waka waka, going to try to do as much as she can, just farm up and try to hit up on the CloudX. But as he's gone, like you said, and we're going to see the backup away from that one. While me, we're going to try to catch up a Zingy, EV card trying to do some stuff as well. I think the biggest thing the 2v1 kind of swaps have done, it kind of eliminated the roam potential for both mid laners, and unfortunately, both of them haven't been really effective. Although EV card has a way, way bigger lead in CS, both of them really haven't shown anything during the actual teamfights or any skirmishes. I mean, yeah, it's 1-0 on the kill score right now, but 111 compared to the 80 CS, it's looking pretty well for this Gragas right now.
Yeah, it's all been about the towers, it's all been about the farm of the dragons, it's not really been about the kills this game. And again, like, with those towers gone, it does lead into some interesting strategies that we could see out from Project Challenger. Now, we do have a Sightstone on Sona. Janna has this Ruby Sightstone, and more wards being purchased. And because we got to purchase so many wards, because we don't have those safety nets, it's kind of putting behind some of the item builds of these guys. I mean, look at Baby Zeus, still not even boots for him either, but he does have one pink to try to grab a little bit of map control back into their favor. But ward on three separate champions plus the stone here for Project Challenger, and they're just kind of, you know, roaming the map and making use of that.
Yeah, that's definitely the truth. And now CloudX gonna try to catch on to CloudX. I think they're gonna try Zinzin, but Valkyrie actually responding to this, gonna try to catch on to CloudX High. Don't think that was the smartest idea. Valkyrie gonna try to get away using his ultimate to try to live another day.
Yeah, Valkyrie will be okay for now. He doesn't have a Brutalizer. He doesn't even have boots either. He's just going to look for that Void Leap to kind of get him from point A to point B. But he also has that Tear of the Goddess. So Tear of the Goddess going to be going into a Mirror Mana sometime later into the game. It's very similar to that of a Jace build. You would get the Tear and then boots into probably a Bloodthirster and then a Brutalizer. He's just looking for all that damage. And as you can see, he does have a BF sword on top of things. Very strange how we have all this early game damage coming out because of global gold objectives, but it's still only 1-0.
And it's just all about that position in the map. When you push down so hard onto turrets, you get this, well, kind of stalemate that you see right now from both teams. Falafel Gaming having the disadvantage off on the turrets, at least, I mean, it is 4-1 on the turret score, so they're going to have to play a little bit defensive. On the other hand, Project Challenger, I mean, they have the wards, like you said, to boot, but they haven't really been utilizing their positioning, their damage output that they could possibly have, and that's because, yeah, they pushed a little bit too early, I would say, and unfortunately, I don't think it's going to be detrimental for now, but it could be detrimental later, especially for Cybolic,
for Waka 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 and everybody else on the team of Falafel Gaming, they're going to have a lot of damage output pretty soon.
Pause coming out. I hope everything is okay for the teams. But, you know, hey, 17 minutes in, let's take a quick look at some of the more items here. As we did see CloudXI nearly grab the kill with that rappel from Valkyrin. He has a Sunfire Cape. So I'm curious to see if we're going to see more of a tanky Elise, or if that Sunfire Cape is just going to be kind of just to sustain this early game, and then he's going to go straight into damage. What do you think?
Probably just staying into damage. I mean, especially what he's going to be building up next. It could be a Merle Mycon, it could be a Philosopher's Stone into Cerulea just to catch up with the team. But overall, the Sunfire Cape is just going to go afford him just a little bit more tankiness, plus push the lane as well. I mean, that magic damage passive is pretty good, and it'll keep CloudXI in a really good state.
Now, on top of things, we do have the Emblem of Valor for Jhin. He also has himself a giant spout, only the tier 1 boots, but, you know, again, we've been seeing more and more runic bulwark starts for our junglers, so I'm curious to see if that's going to be finished up by the time we do get into some kind of team fight. Dragon died at 6, at 12. We should see the next one, like, now, coming up.
It's like 11:45, so 17:45. Yeah, it just got spawned. Okay.
I don't see the... Yeah, there it is. 17:52. Yeah. So yeah, very close to the 18-minute mark. And once again, the teams are just kind of gathering. Now we do have teleports on both of our top laners. They're not here for the fight. That's not going to stop them from coming in if they need to. But a little bit of a standoff right here.
It's kind of interesting seeing all the counter teams kind of going the same way, playing really timid, really passively, and just, you know, trying to win out that spot. And especially for game 3, I'm not surprised everybody really just doing what they're doing right now. But we do see engagement coming in, and Zingy and everybody and the friends are going to try to get on.
We got the Cataclysm going out. The Bullet Time brings EV card real low. Flash in from Baby Zeus, and there's the Slicing Maelstrom on top of the Crescendo. Lots of hit points are now disappearing, but Valkyrie's going to get caught out. CloudXI is able to take him down with the help of Ace, and that's going to be the double with the Ace and the hole from Ace on top of things. Baby Zeus going to be left behind, and that's going to be a triple in for Miss... For Caitlyn, and I don't think Falafel kind of got the wombo combo they wanted.
Again, I'm surprised that Cybolic not actually building it into a Zhonya's Hourglass, but then again, with the Monsoon, Roll 18 just did an amazing job actually just knocking out everybody out of the way so they could save Aces and everybody else to reposition themselves to go back. And overall, a really good take for Aces for 1, 2, 3, a triple kill really working out for her. So she's gonna have a pretty good sizable bank going back into this one, and especially with that dragon to boot, she has enough gold that probably could buy a pretty big item.
4-0 and 4 kills on Caitlyn. She is starting to get a little bit ahead of everyone here. A nice triple for her. She was able to pick up the kill not only on Kha'Zix, on Valkyrin, but the Ace of the Hole came out really nice for the second kill, and then just that last pot shot off on our Sona for the triple. And yeah, her money just absolutely ballooned. Look at her items just kind of explode there, and they got the dragon on top of things. I think that Azingi and team just kind of got outpicked at this point. Like, none of these fights have gone their way.
Yeah, I can definitely agree with that. Unfortunately, I don't know if that's the case, because I feel like, yeah, you could say that they got outpicked, but then again, all you have to do is make sure that you can take care of Janna, or you can take care of Zin, and if you can get off the people that are anti-CC kind of people, then you can pretty much win out the fight. Especially for Roll 18, if she's taken out really early during a fight, it's actually pretty detrimental for the team. But then again, you have all the repositioning that you have from Project Challenger, you have the Caliber Net, you do have the Explosive Cast, and also Repel coming out from CloudXI. So they could dodge out, in theory, every AoE ult imaginable. Is that going to actually happen? Possibly not, and we'll see how both teams will respond to, well, whatever they're going to throw at each other.
Well, I don't know, 4-0, and every time we do jump in. That last fight, I didn't see everyone kind of blowing their load all at the same time, because it did look like they were trying to just stagger it out. Not entirely too sure that Waka Waka is going to care for that, but it looked like they were trying to stagger it out, trying to bait out some of those, you know, fight resets, the explosive cast, the monsoon. But Challenger just didn't take the bait, and as you saw, I mean, 3-0 later in a dragon, it really worked out for them. So I am concerned about, you know, the state of the fights here coming out from Falafel.
But then again, then that's the same way. Falafel Gaming doesn't want to, they shouldn't be blowing their load really early. And if they can force some bad misposition onto Predator Challenger, that's going to have to force the hand of Rolatine or Eevee card to use out their ultimates really early. If they can fight out and make sure that there is a down early, they can probably win out. Oh, Ziggy in a lot of trouble, but CloudX high. Yet again, just showing his presence. He's doing a really, really impressive job with this release. With games, I mean, he just goes in, says hi to AD carry, tries to kill her. Not gonna happen, just gonna go his right out, and then keeps on pushing. That's a really, really strong, it's really strong play coming up from CloudXi.
Well, on top of the Sunfire, we do have another Giant's Belt for CloudXi, so it's really hard to break around.
Yeah, he's probably going to be building into, I would say, Ryla's, or even onto, maybe even into Randomwind. Oh, Waka 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 could be in a little bit of trouble, but CloudX doesn't get the kill. Okay, just push it up even more.
Yeah, it seems to be a little bit more of an unstoppable lane. Now, we still got that teleport from CloudX High, whereas we don't have it here for Cybolic. So in a pinch, she can come mid. We also have this big pressure coming out. Who needs a Baron at this point? 22 minutes in, that tower absolutely melting under the pressure, especially with Ace there in the back, just laying into it. Now, Valkyrin is going to throw out his Void Spikes. We'll see a few hits, but it doesn't really matter. The rest of the team is going to collapse here on top of CloudX High, and this tower is probably not long for this world.
No, it's not looking like it, and it looks like Project Challenger are going to be pushing up and taking a lot of blows onto this tower. Falafel Gaming are going to try to catch up as they can, but Project Challenger, they're just pushing, and they're going to be waiting and baiting yet again. Elise likes to do this tactic. Go in the bush, stay in that bush, make sure that you're like a Garen, and just come up surprise, spin the win. Although it's not really spin the win, it's repel and kill to win. Yeah, maybe that doesn't work the same way, but the Elise is doing the Elise thing, and she is a sneaky, sneaky spider lady.
Yep, out-pushing Shens in this case. You know how people say two Shens? Yeah, so it's going to be like two Elises and all that fun jazz. But 4-0, lots of poke coming out here from Project Challenger as they do carefully, tactically retreat as well. And top lane, you know, we do got a ping going up on top of that. We might see a teleport and just try to push it down, but there's no towers there, so yeah, maybe not. But the creep wave is still pushing. And bottom lane, they're not letting up with this pressure.
Yeah, definitely, and we'll see how they're going to keep on pushing up on this. All members of the team of Falafel Gaming are just pretty much there, except for Kennen going back over top lane. Does have that teleport to come back down if need be. I mean, I like his build, truthfully. He has the best that they have held the guys, but now, oh, Baby Zeus taking that first blow from the ace in the hole. Is that going to be the push or the tilt to go Predator Challenger onto this turret?
We have seen a lot of Ace in the Hole, not really used in terms of everything else, but in terms of initiation, and as Zingy is going to jump in here, Cataclysm into the Crescendo, that's going to be a really decent bullet time, and Cybolic in the back, able to pick up the double, so I don't really know what happened in terms of everything here, Project Challenger, I guess they forgot to hit their ults, but it did not work whatsoever, and Falafel all of a sudden able to take a nice 3-0 exchange despite being so far behind.
It was actually Cybolic flashing over the monsoon and actually still getting into the back line, and the Aces had to back away, Eevee card had to back away, and everybody else in that front line died really quickly. Great, great play coming out from Cybolic over there. Also Valkyrie as well. I mean, a lot of zone that was brought to you by Falafel Gaming, and they kept on that pressure no matter how hard it was. And Aces and Eevee card said, nope, we can't do anything about this. Let's just back away and just lose what we'd lose and just call it for another day. Unfortunately, Ace is in a little bit of trouble right now. Could get caught up by Zingy, but Zingy does not want to follow on to it.
Yeah, good idea from him. The rest of the team is just kind of hovering in and about Ace on top of things. So, hey, sure, a 3-0 exchange, but in terms of the counter pressure, it's pretty much non-existent from Falafel. I mean, they couldn't push any lanes, couldn't push any towers. It looks like they did do some shopping, but, I mean, that was a small price to pay for Project Challenger.
Yeah, definitely, and we'll see what Falafel Gaming can do. We do have Project Challenger going to be able to take out that dragon pretty easily. Baby Z is still clearing out the lane. Yeah, yes. You're going to be able to pick up that Baron or the Baron Ward, and we're going to be seeing the team pick up the Dragon over there.
26 minutes in, another Dragon going the way of the Johto. So see the next one about 32. Maybe he can have better luck up against these teams, but all evidence points to no. 3-4, the gold difference has come down to about 4K. It was a little bit higher, but that 3-0 exchange really did help out Falafel. So if they can get a few more of those, they're going to be right back into this game, and we might see some counter pressure as it is still 5-1.
Yeah, definitely. And now we're going to see a gank over to CloudX High. You're going to take a lot of damage. TV Core going to use the ultimate just to get everybody out of there. Great explosive cast, backing up his friend for that one.
Yeah, it's not that big a cooldown on that explosive cast. You can see it kind of ticking down over on Eevee. It's almost a quarter done, and he just used the silly thing. So yeah, hey, if it keeps CloudX High alive that much longer, then hey, it was definitely a good use. Now, we did get the flash out from CloudX High on top of things, so minor victory coming out from Falafel, but they really could have used a kill there.
Yeah, if they actually got the kill, they could probably pressure out in this middle turret, the tier 1 turret, probably take that down really easily, and then it could be anyone's game for this Baron. Although, I like Falafel Gaming, they're controlling this Baron really well. Unfortunately, now Project Challenger with that Oracle is they're going to have the same command and control backwards, so it's going to be pretty key to say for the supports to stay alive, because again, Oracle is less important in the sense that, yeah, it's on a timer now, but it's still really important to clear out this vision, clear out the next fight to make sure that they have the ultimate vision during the team fight.
3-4, 27 minutes in. This game really started off to a very explosive start, but as you said, kind of really slowed down after that. 7 kills in 28 minutes, especially after we had like 3 towers and a dragon by the 6-minute mark. Definitely a little bit of a change of pace, but Rule 18 has himself the Oracle, is just going to be walking around. Does have a Lock of the Ancestry first item again, and Jhin does have that completed Aegis. So they do got both those really kind of awesome team fight items ready to go. We don't have either of them sitting on Falafel, and once again, we see Jarvan picking up a Shirelia's before really anything else.
Yeah, it's going to be coming in pretty soon. I mean, Shirelia is not a big, big miss buy, but actually not a miss buy at all.
He's
That's pretty cool to see.
Games in a row.
Although the Zingy has been doing a pretty good job with it. Hopefully it'll keep up going well. Oh, Project Challenger going to go catch on the Zingy yet again. CloudX High just poking away. Actually taking a lot of turret aggro. I don't think you want to take that amplification of damage, but I think it's just so that they can take away this turret way faster.
Yeah, solution, kill the turret. There was a lot of creeps there as well, but I mean, with the double giant spell on top of the AoE dot, on top of the haunting guy, like, we got hit points to spare on the spider, and it's not really going to be too much of an issue. So, towers are now down 6-1. Falafel's really kind of relegated to their base. In terms of, you know, vision, you can see more and more members of them buying those wards. They need to keep this map vision. Thankfully, they do have still one ward up by the Baron, but it doesn't seem to be really kind of a priority right now for Challenger.
Yeah, and I'm going to say something about Challenger's build right now. At least she's building that really right. She has that Marilla Mycon being built in for the next little battle. Marilla Mycon, again, is the Grievous Wound effect for the AP side, which means Lifesteal is going to go down a little bit, Spell Vamp's going down a little bit, which is technically onto Kha'Zix as well, and just a lot of damage output. So I'm liking where that's going. Rule 18 going to get take a little bit burst from the front. But it is, like you said before, Project Challenger's game to lose right now. It's looking like Project Challenger is using their comp pretty well.
Yeah, and that's exactly why they picked it. So many resets to try to anti-clump for those wombo combos. They're very, very aware of what happened game number 2, as it was basically their chance for a 2-0, but this secret comp coming out from Azingi and friends really did do a good number on them, so they're really trying hard to make sure that doesn't happen. They did slip up a little bit in the last team fight, and that did bring us to a 4-3 score, and you can see right here the 5-man roam squad with that Oracle, so they know that they're hidden. Your mechanical keyboard's awesome.
Yeah, and definitely, and Morella Namakan being right over there. Sorry about that over there, guys. Yeah, there you go with that item. It's going to be a really good item, actually, to counter all this aggression that's coming out from Falafel Gaming. And it's going to secure more kills, if anything, for that Elise to assassinate onto that backline. So really cool to see that. We'll see what's going to happen if Falafel Gaming actually gets in there and gets anything of a semblance of advantage.
Well, Oracles are still doing their work. I think that was a blue that went to Cloud. I see a blue on now on Cloud, nobody else, so I want to say yes, they did just take that right there.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Then we're going to see the team try to go back onto this one. I'm feeling like Falafel Gaming is trying to like force a fight, and although it might be a good thing, especially with the resets that come in from Valgrind, if they can get some people down, but it might be a really, really undoing thing of themselves, slash they could be the ones coming out on the losers on that one. So hopefully they play it a little bit slow, making sure that they can counter aggress if they need to and disengage if they really need to as well. Because once they're all in onto the team of Project Challenger, there's no real telling story where they're actually going to be at the end of the fight.
Dragon should be coming up in the next 15 seconds or so. That second turret in the Falafel Gaming pocket, I mean, that's going to be some decent cash to bring this gold difference back down to the 4K mark. It seems to be hovering pretty consistent between 4 and 5,000 at this point. But again, Dragon should be coming up fairly soon. And that will be, again, another focal fighting point. Seems to be the big point of contention every time it comes up. There it goes. It's now popped. Nobody actually has a word on it, but the icon should have populated, and you can see them starting to gravitate toward it.
Yeah, Cod's gonna go check around, Valkyrin gonna go over there, say, oh, there's a free dragon roll, we need to get guys, and unfortunately Project Challenger is a little bit ahead of the pack. We do have Zhen going over there, and we do have Eevee trying to look around, trying to think, what are they gonna do about this dragon?
What to do? Is it worth getting another triple kill on Caitlyn for it? Is it worth losing out so many kills to try to contest the worm? I mean, sometimes CLG just has it right. Yeah, it's not worth bothering about it. But right now it is going to get started up. You can see it kind of being kited out, or trying to be kited out, by Project Challenger. Mimo there in the front. Nice shield from Janna. Just going to negate a lot of this. Cybolic looking for that in. A good tornado is going to stop him, but that's the explosive cast, because Zingy's now real low. He can't jump in, and the face in the hole going to hit Cybolic, and that is going to defeat the fight before it even started.
Very, very great little poke, 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 get everybody out so that they can pre-position. Project Challenger just getting everybody out of the way from Falafel Gaming and making sure they can take that. Oh, are they going to try to take over this Baron as well? That's a sneaky play, and they do know that they were pretty low, Falafel Gaming, off of that one, so Project Challenger probably just clearing the wards more of it than trying to take this Baron.
Yeah, I'm more leaning towards just clearing the wards and maybe placing a bait, you know, a nice ambush, because they did get three wards out of it. Rule 18, I'd be very happy with that. But yeah, they're not going to be able to take it, or at least they're not interested in taking it. And at the same time, they're not interested in baiting either. So they're just going to go home, grab some few items that they, you know, a lot of cash from that. The gold difference now back up to the 5,000 mark. So, you know, a little bit of earnings to spend. You see Elise now bottom. She still has that teleport. Cybolic has his up as well. So they can afford to go do those split pushing maneuvers. But, you know, if they're not careful, Elise pushing in on top of a base while a team fight happens north could result in an inhibitor.
Yeah, and that's going to be a dangerous time. Cybolic is going to have to respond to that. And everybody else with Project Challenger probably going to get the time to buy. There's actually a little bit of a timing. Falafel Gaming could have taken Baron by themselves. Unfortunately, that passed with everybody kind of still grouped up around for Project Challenger. And now we're going to see the wards re-clear again. Rule 18 coming in with that Oracle is trying to clear out as much as she can. I'm not surprised of only having the ward over at Baron, making sure that they have some sense of where everyone is. And now Project Challenger yet again going to have control of this Baron area and making sure that they can actually take a small snipe, a kill, or something onto the team of Falafel Gaming.
I think this is actually a really nice strat coming out from Project Challenger. Now, they have a very public Cloud X high down there. If we collapse and try to do a 5-man, 4-man, 3-man gank on top of them, then all of a sudden Project Challenger knows where they are, and since they're hovering in and around the Baron area and they're keeping control of it, would have probably immediately started Baron. Sure, they might lose Cloud out of it, but he is fairly tanky. He has a Crystal Scepter. He has the Morella Namakon. He has the Sunfire Cape and a Haunting Guise on top of that. I mean, the hit points and the sustain there is in spades. But because they would have collapsed on top of him, they probably would have gotten a Baron, which means that, again, Falafel loses. So they don't collapse on top of him, and they contest this Baron, and Elise still pushes, gets more farm, and gets that much more head. And they still win that trade-off. So, again, like, big strategy going on here.
And it's just the problem and the unfortunate demise of those top two turrets in their beginning, and now the top or the middle two turrets as well. I mean, having that position, having that zone, and having no control in the jungle is really hurting Falafel Gaming in there. Now we do see Cloud XI and Cybolic talking to each other over in that bottom line. Cloud XI is pretty low. Can Cybolic win out this matchup?
That's going to be real close if it did come down to the wire, but he is going to back on off. Both of them did get low, but I think that Cloud XI with another round of cooldowns would have been able to take the shot. And Cybolic kind of realizing that and saying, all right, I got to get out of dodge. Now the fun times, Cloud XI not leaving. Again, if we have people come down here and try to face him, they're going to go straight for Baron. If they don't, she's able to push for free. Win-win.
Yeah, and that's going to be the problem that Falafel Gaming is going to respond. How are they going to respond by this? They should push hard over that top and push hard over the middle so that they can have some semblance of control. Only unfortunate thing is, Ace's EV card, they can clear creep waves pretty fast, so they can't really do anything about that. Ooh, there might be a little tick, and Zingy might be in trouble.
Zingy gonna have to flash on out of that one. Lots of pressure coming his way. He is under half. He's just gonna hit the F right there, I guess. Okay, maybe not. I wouldn't have actually recalled there myself, but Ward going out from Cybolic. They want to make sure that they don't get caught about this again. And once again, Wards are going out from both teams, but both teams are also rocking Oracles. So, I mean, the Wards really don't last that long right now. The Christmas tree of the map, unfortunately, does not exist. And looks like we're going to have a bit of a reset in terms of the fight and the push. 37 minutes in, we're about to hit that sweet spot, that 40 to 45 minute. And in terms of the item builds, you know, definitely rocking 2 to 3 items, if not 4. I'm looking at Miss Fortune. I'm looking at Caitlyn right now. Phantom Dancer, the BF sword is probably going to go into her 5th item, but she has herself the Last Whisper, the Bloodthirst, and the Boots. And the next step after that would be, you know, ditching the Dorns.
Yeah, it's probably going to be an Infinity Edge or something like that, but I wouldn't be surprised as well if Ace is just going to a defensive item, maybe getting like a BV or something like that to stop one of these great AoE ults as well. I mean, the biggest thing that Caitlyn needs to do is just keep on poking and getting there. Ooh, Waka 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 going to be able to dodge out that Kakuna, and Cybolic going to be able to take that Voidling Spiderling so that they can actually save up themselves. This might be a really good push for Project Challenger onto this bottom lane.
So many wards just trailing them. Look, like, if they came from Baron, between the traps and the wards from Baron, you can clearly see where they kind of walked. It's kind of funny. But yeah, big pressure, bottom lane. We do, I think, have all the ults up. Just taking a quick look around the place. We don't have the ace in the hole because we just, I think, threw that off from aces. Once again, not really using it as a finisher, using it more of a poke. It doesn't exactly have a huge cooldown, so you can use it again and again, and it's guaranteed to hit something. Whether or not it's what you want it to hit. So Cloud XI, if he can land a cocoon, or we can get a nice explosive cast from EV card, we might be able to insta-give someone from Falafel, but the reverse is also kind of true. If we get a nice catch here and the wombo combo is successful from Falafel, they could easily get a kill on top of Project Challenger. So it's a delicate situation.
Yeah, definitely, and we'll see what Project Challenger and Falafel can be doing about the next little fight. Just knowing some of the item builds, we have the Rally's Crystals up there already set up for that 302 CS, at least. Great job by Cloud XI doing that one right over there. Dragon gonna go right to the Project Challenger yet again because of the control that they have, and they're gonna keep up this gold advantage. On the other hand, we have double Bloodthirster coming out from the team of Falafel Gaming, having that on the Misfortune and also on the Kha'Zix, as well as possible Baron take. Really interesting to see. Might be a desperation Baron from Falafel Gaming.
Well, when you're behind, you gotta do something. That gold lead has only started to get wider and wider now, back at that 6,000 mark. But it was also good timing because half of the team of Project Challenger was back in base. I can't see the Baron hit points, but that's gonna be a real quick kill. And the Baron is gonna go to Jarvan. So not only is Sona gonna be able to flash and get that crescendo, Azingi's now in there as well. The dunk is gonna hit Rule 18. It doesn't matter. That's gonna not hit the bullet time. And all of a sudden, Falafel Game is looking superb as they're able to take home 4 kills for 1, get the Baron, and we should be able to put up some really nice pressure, maybe all the way to the inhibitor from off that.
That's definitely going to be an inhibitor down for the team of Project Challenger. They shouldn't have actually taken that dragon, and unfortunately that dragon take said, okay, Falafel Gaming, let's go take this down, let's go get this Baron, and let's get it fast. And then the biggest problem that came into play with the actual team fight starting up, Project Challenger kind of trickled in one by one by one, and when you do that during a team fight, you're pretty much going to lose out, unfortunately. And Falafel Gaming kind of took that advantage, kind of took that experience and said, yeah, we can do this and we can actually win out this fight. So great job to them. They're going to be able to take up this inhibitor turret. I don't think they're going to press on for the inhibitor itself, but they're going to take this and close out that gold lead, only 1k down.
Wow, we go from 6 grand down to the 1-3-4 kills later after all is done and dusted. 7-5, still really low kill count, but the 40-minute sweet spot is really earning its name here as we're now, again, having these bigger and bigger impactful team fights. Because of that fight, we're able to grab 2 towers, not quite the inhibitor, but still, a lot of things were done right there from Falafel. But not only that, their morale has to be really good right now knowing that they can still fight this out for a win.
Yeah, they could fight this one out for a win, and I'm thinking, like, this is just a reset in the game. It's anyone's game now, especially at the 40-minute go. There's no resets that are going to help out the team of Project Challenger. And unfortunately, with their team comp, I think at least is pretty much the only thing that really cares about in the late game. While on the other hand, Falafel Gaming, having that Kennen, having that J4, having that Kha'Zix especially as well. We didn't really talk about Kha'Zix's items. I mean, yeah, we did say the Bloodthirster, we did say some Last Whisperage, but now with the Warmox to boot, plus maybe building into a Black Cleaver, it's gonna be very dangerous facing this Kha'Zix soon.
Now, as a quick note, I mean, we did start the games a few minutes late back at the noon PDT mark, but it is also now past 3:15, and FXO Open has now actually started their game. So, sad face. A little saddened there. So, I don't know who you want to cover after this bird, but we might just be relegated to Tiza.
Yeah, that's true. I think we're going to be watching Big Fat GG, so we'll get there, no problem. Yeah.
I'm down with that. I also looks like Falafel Gaming's down for grabbing more global gold into their pocket. The gold difference now down to 500. We got the one-on-one bot lane, the 4-on-4 top. Everyone's just kind of abandoned the middle again. But, you know, Dragon and Baron timers are still way far away from now. And we could see some really nice pushes. If that's going to be a fight in the jungle, I don't think that we're going to get a win out of Project Challenger if that's going to be the case.
Yeah, we're probably not going to see that happen, and we're going to see everybody back away from the team of Falafel Gaming Project Challenger right now. Yeah, I mean, they hit a wall. This is what happens sometimes when you hit those 2v1s and you actually take the successful take onto actually taking down the turrets really fast. Again, farm's not going to be more accessible, so at this point, yeah, it's pretty good that you can push down this wave, but now they're at a point where they have control of all the 2-2 turrets, but they don't have control actually of the map. It's all actually on Falafel Gaming side, especially with the inhibitor open right now. So hopefully Falafel Gaming can know that they just need to push it at the top or the bottom lane when they can, but the top lane even more so to provide this pressure so that they can push into the middle inhibitor and take them down really easily. On the other hand, Predator Challenger, really what they need to do is actually group up a little bit more. Yeah, you know you do have that teleport for Codex High, but is that really going to be enough to hold off onto these team fights that are going to happen really soon? I don't know. Hopefully it will work out for the team, but it's looking pretty grim for them as of now.
So Elise hoofed it all the way up to the top lane. Symbolic is still bottom. So if I was Falafel Gaming, I would just back off and keep the pressure here while Symbolic pushes down that bottom. And that might actually be what they're going to be doing, because now they're looking at Elise. She's crossing the map yet again to get back to that bottom lane because Symbolic is not letting it up. And now the 4-on-4 pressure top lane, they got to be feeling much better about that. And the wave clear is pretty decent here from Falafel. They should be able to start chipping away at the tower and maybe even grab it for free. And Kha'Zix, he's going to go straight into the mid. He's like, oh, look, an inhibitor. That just pulls even more people away from top. And there you go. The red turret now down. Really nice plays coming out from Falafel here.
Yeah, Falafel Gaming just pushing up and taking that one down. Project Challenger, they're looking around. They're going to see their base is kind of falling apart, unfortunately. And Valkyrie and everybody else with Falafel Gaming now taking control of the jungle. This was just the flip side. Over at the 20-minute go, Project Challenger was out at the base of Falafel Gaming and they were pushing out over in that bottom lane. Unfortunately, they couldn't clean up, and now we'll see if Falafel Gaming, on the other hand, can actually clean up on this one at 45 minutes in. They had the damages, they had the technology, will they use it for the right abilities?
I gotta say, it feels good to have much longer League of Legends games again. Like, Season 2, the average was like 35 to 40 minutes. Season 3, it became like this big rush stats. I like to see 6 item teams go head-to-head. I think it's just pure beauty in its best form. But the Dragon going down again, 45-30, more or less, a little bit earlier. So we'll see the next one at the 51-30 mark if we do get that far. Game number one, I think, did go to about the 52-minute mark. So we are, starting to traverse that sweet spot now more into the ultra-late game when people are now finishing up. And as you can see, the ADCs are starting to pump out massive damage. Kha'Zix has himself a Warmog for that survivability when he does jump into things. We got the Runic, we got the Shirelias, we got double Shirelias and a Locket on top of Falafel. And we do got that Zhonya's and the Crystal and the Abyssal on top of a Haunting Guise for our Kennen. So Cybolic, he's been really up there despite the low amount of kills of this game. And in terms of the creeps, we're not exactly pushing 400 quite yet, so a little bit lower than game number one or game number two, but we are into the 350 range.
Yeah, it's because of the 2v1 and everything being denied for both top laners. I think it was Cloud High was at the 400 mark before, and also it was Cybolic at the 400 mark as well. So, they didn't have that extra free time of just free farming whenever they wanted to over that bottom lane. And in this time, it is going to be Falafel Gaming controlling the Baron yet again.
Did that Baron just spawn?
I think it did, and that's why everyone's just going to go over it. And Cloud XI is still waiting in the bush, trying to get a trap. Unfortunately, I don't think the trap is going to really work out. And it's going to be a big, big GG over here for Falafel Gaming.
We got a teleport
right
coming in, Cybolic from bot lane. I think Elise probably would have reported that. Not entirely too sure why.
I think it was just Falafel Gaming. I think it was Falafel Gaming's Cybolic because he uses the Mustang standard sound. What's up?
But why did he teleport?
Just push up the team just to get more damage in. I don't know. That's true.
Safety measures then. Okay. Cool. Five-man push coming in mid. There's a really tasty inhibitor there. Zingy's going to take a good amount of damage, though, but it doesn't matter. Misfortune with the Waka Waka DPS, and it got absolutely melted. Now, we're probably at a point that we can just tank tower straight out. Are we going to see that here bottom? The rest of Project Challenger saying we don't even want to consider that possibility, and all five of them just kind of stormed down here as well.
Well, especially with the inhibitor down, you have the extra 8 health that's going to come out from the side lanes over in top and bottom, so they're going to push up even more. So the actual important tower is actually the top inhibitor turret more than this bottom second turret. If they can defend this bottom circuit turret without having the top inhibitor turret taking a lot of damage, that'd be really great. And especially with that wave coming in from top, they should be able to hold off the damage off on this bottom inhibitor or bottom second turret for a little bit longer. Unfortunately for Falafel Gaming, they noticed that as well, so they might have to send somebody back. And this is going to delay their push maybe a little bit, but then again, if they can catch onto somebody, they might be able to kill onto, anyone of the team Project Challenger.
That ace in the hole, man, it starts really hurting late game. And once again, just kind of using it, they're trying to poke down the team of Falafel Gaming enough so that when the push comes to shove, the team fights will go for Project Challenger. You can also see the Cupcake Brigade set up, the Cupcake Wall, the impassable barrier of deliciousness. But we're really just holding on to threads here at this point. We need one good solid team fight that could determine who's going to take home the win here.
Yeah, that is true. And Falafel Gaming now have to respond to top. They're going to send Valkyrie to co-clear that up. And we're going to see the push up yet again. Don't think they need to send anyone over mid. I feel like they should just control the buffs of Project Challenger, take over red, take over their blue buff as well. The wards are pretty immense actually coming out from Project Challenger, so that might be a bad kind of steal. But then again, Falafel Gaming, the six wards that are there near the red buff, near the blue buff, keeping everything on eyes. But it might be a good thing for Falafel Gaming in the sense that, okay, we're just going to keep on pushing. We have this Baron buff. We can actually wait out another Baron buff if we really need to. But I feel that'd be a little bit dragging on for the team of Falafel Gaming.
Yeah, we got 2 minutes or so until Dragon does come back up, and we only got about a quarter of the time left here on the Baron buff. So if something is going to happen, it has to be fairly soon if they want to make use of it. So it basically equates down to another 60 seconds of Baron goodness, and then the 3-minute timer until he does come back up. So it's, a little under 2 minutes here for the Dragon, 3 minutes there. Oh, sorry, 4 minutes for the Baron. And again, big pressure coming in from the bottom lane. They do already have that inhibitor mid, but look at that sneaky Kha'Zix on the minimap.
Is he actually going to go up the top lane and try to finish up something, or is he just pushing up mid to provide pressure?
No, I
think he's going to go in for a gank. He's going to pincer the whole team of Project Challenger.
That's risky.
That's a little risky, yeah. He's thinking about it. I think he's just going to push up the wave and just provide some pressure so they have to get off of there.
Yeah, if he had come in for a pincer maneuver, I think he just would have gotten insta-gib down. But he is up there in the mid, and he is going to be enough to just kind of force the team back. That's going to be the tower kill now on bot. And now with the Celerity going forward, Baby Zeus and team going to be trying for this next one. So, yeah, Valkyrin ended up being quite the distraction. They were able to grab themselves the turret. Probably wouldn't have went down by just sheer pressure anyways, but... it's kind of an interesting tactic. Valkyrin doesn't have that teleport, Cybolix isn't up anyways, but he's still kind of wandering around, just showing his face and trying to bait them out from this defensive maneuver.
Now, Cybolix going to have the teleport probably in the next 15 to 20 seconds. He's going to be the one pushed over in the top lane. Everybody else of the Team Predator Challenger just turtling up as they can. Their middle inhibitor should be up within the next minute or so. It went down pretty early, or... like before the Baron take actually, so that should be coming up pretty soon, and we'll see how they're going to answer Project Challenger to Falafel Gaming's events.
Yeah, it should be more or less 2 minutes until Baron. I don't know if we're going to stall out for a third Baron in order to try to win the game. They didn't really make use of the first or second one. I mean, sure, it won them the team fight, and they took some towers, and then the second time they took some towers, so... a law of averages coming out. If they do get a third Baron, they will probably win a fight and take some towers. But Cybolix able to take down that top one. Once again, the baiting maneuver, the split pushing maneuvers working really well here for Falafel. They're able to push a lot of pressure on the different lanes. And now that's going to be a second naked inhibitor in that top lane.
Yeah, but the middle inhibitor just not respond just yet, so the damage output coming up from the allies is still really good, and we do see a lot of wards coming out. Eevee Carr going to take out a little bit of blow from the Void Spikes. Is Azingi going to go in a little soon onto this one? I hope not. Cybolix is ready, and he has his Zalian's Hourglass to prove that. So he's going to be coming in. Eevee Carr going to start this one up.
Oh, that's going to be the cask, and they only brought Zingi down to half, so that's one of the tools to kind of reset. There's the Crescent Sweep as well, but it doesn't matter. Zingi just goes in just Voidberg style for the kill. Rue 18 is going to drop the bullet time, just massive damage on top of Cloud9, and they're going to have to force him back. Zingi's now in the back as well, Cybolix. So the hit points overall from left to right, the ace in the hole not able to take home a kill. Very low on all of the survivors, but it did end up 2-for-1 and the inhibitor going to Falafel Gaming. So 9-6, they've extended their gold lead. They were down 6 grand at one point. Now they're up by 3, and if they go home and reset and they wait for Valkyrin, maybe they don't even need to wait for Valkyrin, but this Baron is about to spawn any minute now.
Yeah, with the Baron respawning, it should be really just GG for Falafel Gaming off on... Project Challenger for Falafel Gaming. Falafel Gaming, all they need to do is keep on this control, keep on pressuring when they can. I mean, all they're gonna have to do right now is pretty much just bringing down that middle inhibitor turret, or middle inhibitor, and then possibly push down the bottom inhibitor turret. They don't really need to do that. They have a lot of damage, and they have a lot of potential just to kill onto everyone. And especially with the reset comp not really working in for Eevee Card and everybody else, they can't really do too much about this, and if they can protect Ace, they can do a lot of good things, but unfortunately, Ace is going to get dove upon from one of the three AoE ults, or one of the three gap closing characters with that cannon, with that Azingi, with that J4, and also onto the Kha'Zix.
Alright, this might be the fight to determine the rest of the game. Everyone is up, we're looking at ultimates, Crescent Sweep should be coming up in just a moment. Everything else, I think, is ready to go. Okay, Cybolix is about to pop, and I think the bullet time is about to pop as well, and yes, there we go. So, this Baron is very likely a very instrumental force coming into here. Baby Zeus is going to get caught out, does get hit by that ace in the hole. Bullet time's not really going to graze too many people, but Baby Zeus somehow able to get out of that one despite his base hit points nerf. We do got a Zingi now in there. That's going to be Cybolix coming in for his teleport into the ultimate. Valkyrin, however, is able to score the kill on top of Ace and the double. And now he's not done quite yet. He's going to be chasing after Rule 18 in a wild Mimo. Doesn't quite land him there, but a Zingi might be able to hit that. Demacian gets hit by the cocoon instead. And now Cybolix, I don't quite think he has the cooldowns really to chase after this. Sona still somehow alive. Still a very impressive feat from her. There goes the tornado from Valkyrin. And I don't think we're going to grab the kill, but we might be able to end the game.
Cloudx is just going to get beat it out. I don't think he meant to die. He meant to overcruise the meter, didn't actually do anything. Unfortunately, you're going to die out from that one, but they're going to push up for the Nexus turrets. They're going to take it down one Cybolix with Waka Waka Waka. Going to be able to finish up the second Nexus turret, and this should be the game Falafel Gaming.
Like Baby Zeus sacrificed himself. He hit Cloud XI. Made sure he did not go back. And he bought enough time for the team to take down the Nexus. So congratulations, Falafel, clawing back to the victory to take it 2-1 over Project Challenger here in the North America promotional series for the LCS. That was an extremely long series, Mr. Bird.